Meantime, so much of what Congress will prioritize in the new year does come down to control of the U.S. Senate. Lisa's also been reporting on the two Senate runoff races looming next month in the state of Georgia. Today is the voter registration deadline for the elections that will determine the Senate majority.
The nation's immediate future comes down to this, one month in one state. A mad sprint in Georgia. Democrats need to win both U.S. Senate runoffs in January in order to control the chamber. Republicans need to keep their base fired up.
The stake in this election is control of the U.S. Senate, and that really means control of this country.
President Trump, who spoke in Valdosta Saturday, may not be on the ballot, but he is a force in the race.
It's rigged. It's a fixed deal.
This weekend, as he campaigned for the Republican Senate incumbents, Kelly Loeffler and David Perdue, Mr. Trump falsely charged again that the state's election, which Joe Biden won, was illegitimate.
You know, we won Georgia, just so you understand.
I am worried about it. It's a mixed message.
Buzz Brockway is a Republican and former Georgia state representative. He believes his party has the edge in both Senate races, but the president's message is confusing.
You know, it's, hey, I want you to vote for the Republican candidates, Perdue and Loeffler, but the election was rigged and the machine stole, flipped votes and absentee ballots were stolen. So I've heard from people, I've heard from dozens of people who say, I'm not going to vote. And you know, I hope that that's just the emotion of the moment.
More than emotion, it's a movement from some Trump supporters like Lynn Wood, who at a rally last week told Republicans to stay home.
Why would you go back and vote in another rigged election? For God's sakes, fix it. You gotta fix it before we'll do it again.
Are you ready to stand up one more time?
Meantime, Democrats are also pinning their underdog hopes to the same strategy that they believe won the state for Biden.
We won this election decisively.
The effort led by Stacey Abrams to register new voters, especially voters of color who are growing in Georgia. Andra Gillespie is a political science professor at Emory University in Atlanta.
Now blacks make up about 30% of all registered voters in the state. And in the last decade, we have seen the number of proportion of Asian American and Hispanic voters double in the state.
Gillespie says this contest is entirely about base turnout. Democrats are bringing in their superstars.
We got to win this thing.
Former presidential hopeful Andrew Yang has literally moved to the state to help, and former President Barack Obama has campaigned virtually.
The special election in Georgia is going to determine ultimately the course of the Biden presidency and whether Joe Biden and Kamala Harris can deliver legislatively all the commitments they've made.
Are you ready to organize?
It's the enthusiasm fight. Bill Nygut of Georgia Public Broadcasting.
The circumstances here are unlike anything we've ever seen. We're close to having a million absentee ballots applied for in Georgia. That's only about 200,000-300,000 fewer than at this time prior to the November 3rd election.
To the Trump tornado, add multiple firestorms and attacks surrounding the candidates themselves. Incumbent Republican Senators David Perdue and Kelly Loeffler, both former corporate CEOs, have faced headlines about their stock trades. Loeffler for trades she made after a senator's only briefing on the pandemic. An ethics committee found no violations, but the issue has hovered over her. Perdue has been scrutinized for thousands of trades he made that involved companies his committee directly oversaw. Republicans are just as sharply on attack. Example, Loeffler's words last night at a debate.
My opponent, radical liberal Raphael Warnock, is a socialist.
To this, her opponent, Democrat Raphael Warnock, the pastor at historic Ebenezer Baptist Church in Atlanta, responded with an ad.
I think Georgians will see her ads for what they are.
And a simple gesture.
Don't you?
David Perdue wasn't even at that.
Ads are part of a massive wave of cash again washing over the state.
It wouldn't be surprising to many people, you know, if this ended up being somewhere in the neighborhood of a $500 million race. The fact that so much money is pouring into Georgia is evidence of how competitive these races are. I think if one party had a clear advantage over the other and it was very comfortable and substantial, we wouldn't see this level of spending.
The intensity will keep rising, along with the money spent and the high-profile visits. President-elect Joe Biden says he plans to visit Georgia soon. It's great to meet you.
Among the complex issues here is timing. The Georgia runoffs are January 5th. The new Senate begins January 3rd. Judy?
So, Lisa, explain how that works. And also, I mean, remind us what is on the line here in terms of America's future in how these races turn out.
I cannot stress enough how every conversation I have with any kind of source, be it about housing, be it about the coronavirus, any conversation I'm having right now, people on or off the Hill, comes back to the Georgia election. It affects everything, the direction of this country. It especially will affect the next round of coronavirus relief, which is one reason that House Speaker Nancy Pelosi is okay with a smaller deal right now. They expect a bigger package and more stimulus next year. It will also affect any chance of climate change legislation, health care, all of it on the table right now in Georgia.
All eyes on Georgia, and they are going to continue to be until that runoff election takes place. Lisa Desjardins, thank you for filling us in on both of these important stories.